Good day, children. So today we will move on to the lesson from the textbook Moments. The first lesson from the text is titled The Lost Child by Mulk Raj Anand. Mulk Raj Anand was an Indian writer in English, and he was notable for his depiction of lives of the poorer caste in traditional Indian society. He, along with writers like R.K. Narayan, Ahmad Ali, Raja Rao, were one of the first Indian-based writers in English who gained international readership. He is admired for his novels and short stories, which acquired the status of classics of modern Indian-English literature. They are noted for their perspective, insight into the lives of the oppressed, and for their analysis of impoverishment, exploitation, and misfortune. Now, let's move on to the lesson. This lesson is about a little child who goes to a fair with his parents. Now, I'm sure you all know what a fair is. It's almost like a festival. And you have a lot of shops, you have a lot of entertainment things, and you know, a lot of things like that. He's happy and he's excited and he wants to buy all the sweets and the toys which are displayed there. Now, his parents does not buy it for him. But then when someone else offers to buy it for him, he refuses that person. Why does he do that? Let's look at the lesson and find out. It was the festival of spring. From the wintry shades of narrow lanes and alleys emerged a gaily clad humanity. Some walked, some rode on horses, others sat being carried on bamboo and bullock carts. One little boy ran between his father's legs, brimming over with life and laughter. So, it was a time of spring, it was a festival of spring, and the winter season had passed by, and people have all come out into the street, they have all come out of the street, and they are all happily clad or covered, they are all around the place. People, some were walking, some rode on horses, others sat on it, some were carried in bamboo and bullock carts, and there was this little boy who was running between his father's leg, and he was brimming over. He was full of life and laughter. "Come, child, come," called his parents as he lagged behind, fascinated by the toys in the shops that lined the way. He hurried towards his parents, his feet obedient to their call, his eyes still lingering on the receding toys. As he came to where they had stopped to wait for him, he could not suppress the desire of his heart, even though he well knew the old, cold stare of refusal in their eyes. So, you know, whenever the boy lagged behind or was slow behind, he was seeing or looking at all the toys in the shops which were on the way. He was fascinated by all the toys displayed. His parents used to call out to him, asking him to come along. And he used to hurry towards his parents, and his feet was always obedient to their call, but his eyes were still lingering or looking for a longer period on the receding toys or the gradually diminishing image of the toys. And whenever he came to where his parents were waiting for him, he knew that, you know, there was this same old stare of refusal in their eyes. "I want the toy," he pleaded. His father looked at him, red-eyed, in his familiar tyrant's way. His mother, melted by the free spirit of the day, was tender and giving him her finger to hold, said, "Look, child, what is before you?" It was a flowering mustard field, pale like melting gold as it swept across miles and miles of even land. So whenever he asked for the toy, he pleaded for the toy, his father always gave him a tyrant's look. A tyrant is a cruel ruler, so he always looked at the child angrily, whereas a mother who was melted by seeing the free spirit of her child, and she gave him her finger to hold, and she tried to distract him and asked him to look at in front of him. So there was a flowering mustard field which was pale or light shaded like melting gold as it lay across them. A group of dragonflies were bustling about on their gaudy purple wings, intercepting the flight of a lone black bee or butterfly in search of sweetness from the flowers. The child followed them in the air with his gaze till one of them would still its wings and breast, and he would try to catch it. But it would go fluttering, flapping up into the air when he had almost caught it in his hands. Then his mother gave a cautionary call. Come, child, come. Come onto the footpath. So, as he looked at the fields in front of him, there was a group of dragonflies which were bustling about. Bustling means they were moving in a very energetic manner on their gaudy purple wings. Gaudy is bright or shiny purple wings, and which had intercepting flight of a lone black. Intercepting is obstructed by, or it is, there was a kind of blocking. It was blocked by the group of dragonflies. You know, sometimes their sight is blocked by maybe a single bee or a butterfly which was there. So we look at the way in which the author is describing the scene, and the child followed these little tiny flies with its and he used to try and catch these dragonflies, and whenever he tried to catch it, it went fluttering away, and the mother would give him a cautionary call or give him a word of caution, that asking him to come to the footpath. He ran towards his parents gaily and walked abreast of them for a while, being however soon left behind, attracted by the little insects and worms along the footpath that were teeming out from their hiding places to enjoy the sunshine. Come, child, come, his parents called from the shade of a grove where they had seated themselves on the edge of a well. He ran towards them. So the little boy, once he received the cautionary call from his mother, he ran towards his parents happily, and he walked ahead of them for a while, but however soon he was left behind again because he was attracted by these tiny little insects and the worms which are there on the footpath, which were trying to come out from its hiding place seeing the sunlight. And the parents used to call out to the child from the shade of a grove or a little place near the edge of the well. A shower of young flowers fell upon the child as he entered the grove, and forgetting his parents, he began to gather the raining petals in his hand. But lo, he heard the cooing of doves and ran towards his parents shouting, "The dove! The dove!" The raining petals dropped from his forgotten hands. "Come, child, come," they called to the child, who had now gone running in wild capers round the banyan tree, and gathering him up, they took the narrow winding footpath which led to the fair through the mustard fields. So he is distracted from one image to another, you know. So the child is distracted by the toys, and then the child is now distracted by the insects and the worms that he sees on the footpath. And now that they are sitting in a grove or shade of a tree, what happened is, There was flowers were falling off the tree. It was a spring season. There was a fall of petals, and he was collecting these petals in his hands when he heard the cooing of the doves, and then he started running towards it. He's calling out to his parents saying that there's a dove, and he forgets about the petals there, and he goes out to get hold of the dove. And he had ran towards a banyan tree, and they went towards him, caught hold of him, and they started walking to the fair through the mustard field. As they neared the village, the child could see many other footpaths full of throngs converging to the whirlpool of the fair, and felt at once repelled and fascinated by the confusion of the world he was entering. So as he neared the village, he could see there were many other footpaths which were full of throngs, means it's a large densely packed crowd of people. Okay, so the place was densely packed and fully packed, converging to the whirlpool of the fair, means to meet a point, you know, like the whirlpool. It was almost like the world was surrounded by people. They were filled with people. The child was fascinated by seeing all these confusion that he was entering into. A sweetmeat seller hawked gulab jamun, rasagulla, burfi, jalebi at the corner of the entrance, and a crowd pressed round his counter at the foot of an architecture of many coloured sweets decorated with leaves of silver and gold. The child stared open-eyed, and his mouth watered for the burfi that was his favourite sweet. "I want that burfi," he slowly murmured. But he half knew as he begged that his plea would not be heeded, because his parents would say he was greedy. So without waiting for an answer, he moved on. So as he entered the fair, he sees a sweetmeat seller calling out with the variety of sweets that are there. And he could see that there was an architecture of many colored sweets, means the way in which the sweets are decorated on the counters. You know, it's almost like, you know, if you have noticed, you go to your bakeries or the sweet shops, you will see that how, you know, the laddus and the jalebis and, you know, the gulab jamuns are all placed, you know, they arrange it in a very neat structure. And the child's favorite sweet was burfi. He knew his request will be denied, but slowly he asked for the burfi, but without waiting for an answer. He knew that his parents will say that he's greedy, so he just, without waiting for an answer, he moves on. A flower seller hawked a garland of gulmohar, a garland of gulmohar. The child seemed irresistibly drawn. He went towards a basket where the flowers lay heaped and half murmured, "I want that garland." But he well knew his parents would refuse to buy him those flowers because they would say that they were cheap. So without waiting for an answer, he moved on. So the next he comes across a flower seller who was selling a garland of gulmohar, and the child was drawn towards it, and he wanted that garland, but he knew his parents would refuse him by saying that the flowers were cheap. So without again waiting for an answer from them, he moved on. A man stood holding a pole with yellow, red, green, purple balloons flying from it. The child was simply carried away by the rainbow glory of their silken colors, and he was filled with an overwhelming desire to possess them all. But he well knew his parents would never buy him the balloons because they would say he was too old to play with such toys. So he walked on farther. So the next he came across a man who was holding a pole which had a different colored balloons, and the child, being a small young child, he wanted all those colored balloons, but he knew that his parents would say that he was too old to play with such toys. So without asking anything, he just walked forward. A snake charmer stood playing a flute to a snake which coiled itself in a basket, its head raised in a graceful bend like the neck of a swan, while the music stole into its invisible ears like the gentle rippling of an invisible waterfall. The child went towards the snake charmer, but knowing his parents had forbidden him to hear such coarse music as the snake charmer played, he proceeded farther. So the next he comes across a snake charmer who stood there playing the flute to the snake, and the way in which the snake was coiled in the basket, it raised its head and it, you know, danced to the tune of the flute. And the child went towards the snake charmer, but he knew that, you know, he was aware that his parents had forbidden him to listen to such kind of music that are played by the snake charmers. So he just moves forward. There was a roundabout in full swing. Men, women and children, carried away in a whirling motion, shrieked and cried with dizzy laughter. The child watched them intently, and then he made a bold request. "I want to go on the roundabout, please, father, mother." So now he comes across a roundabout. You know what a roundabout is, isn't it? You go to your fairs, or you even go to any of the theme parks. You go to Wonderla or anywhere, you come about roundabouts. And you know, especially in the fairs, you will find all people of all ages get into the roundabout, and they carry the people. People shriek, they cry, they laugh with, you know, being dizzy. And the child was watching all that, and you know, this time he decided to make a very bold request, and he requested them that he wanted to go on the roundabout. Okay, so this is the end of part 1. Thank you, children.